All right. Well, good morning, afternoon, evening to everybody who's joined in so far. Appreciate you, everyone, taking time out of your day to listen in on this webinar. Before we get started with the actual content that Sean's going to be presenting today, I want to just give a quick introduction to DSIAC as an organization, give a little bit of overview of the logistics here of the webinar, and then we can jump straight into the presentation. So quickly, DSIAC, as an organization, we are the Defense Systems Information Analysis Center. We are a DoD entity under DTIC that support the DoD research and engineering community by conducting information research on technical topics. We've got a staff of technical folks who can help you find information on any defense systems technical topic you might have. So if you would like to request our services, you know, we are more than happy to help you out in any sort of research project you're working on. We provide those services in an effort to help reduce the redundancy that goes on in DoD research engineering, help make sure that we're connecting people to maybe similar work projects that are going on, and then create a general awareness of work that's either been done or being done to support the DoD community. So hosting these webinars is one way that we accomplish that. We want to push out an awareness of work that's being done. And so, you know, this work that Sean will be presenting on is a project that was originally conducted for the DoD community kind of at large. Again, if you want any more information on our organization, I would encourage you to just head to our website, DSIAC.org, to poke around, see what you can find. You can submit some questions to us, request our help, support for whatever you might be working on. So that's enough about who we are as an organization in terms of logistics for the webinar that you're in. For those who are in the webinar platform, the AnyMeeting platform through their browser, you'll be able to see the slides and of course here as we go through everything. If you have any technical issues during the time and you can't see the slides, maybe have some issue with audio through the browser, you can always dial in using the phone number that's been provided. You obviously won't be able to see the slides or the presentation, but I'd encourage you to at least listen in. There's on the website or the web page for this particular webinar on our website, there's a link to download the PDF version of some slides that will help you to Looks like I might have been knocked off for a second. Okay. And then kind of lastly here for question and answers. So we are going to have a question and answer session at the end after Sean's presentation. Between now and then, if you have any questions at all during the presentation, I would encourage you to kind of get them in queue so we can handle them at the Q&A portion at the end. If you're in the AnyMeetings browser platform here, at the top of your screen, you should see a little kind of a dialogue icon that allows you to enter audience questions. You can type in your question there, submit it, and we'll get it in queue to answer it. I want to distinguish that from the attendee chat that you might be able to see. That's a place. I'm seeing there's no audio. Okay, well, I'm seeing that. So the attendee chat is where you can enter messages that will come to us or each other. So if you do have a question, I encourage you to put it in the question, audience question field at the top as opposed to the chat. And then lastly, we are recording this. We'll make it available afterwards. So if you have any technical issues, you'll be able to pick up on it at a later date and view the recording then. Okay. I think that's everything I wanted to cover. So without further ado, I will hand it over to Sean. Sean, all yours.
Good morning, everyone, or afternoon, depending on where you're placed at. I'm working for service, currently a project manager with them, working in the aviation area. I was 22 years in the Army as both a maintainer and as a pilot. So this project being dropped in my lap kind of last minute last year was pretty neat because I'd spent 11 years of my time in the Army as a maintainer myself, and I could see the relevance of what they were trying to do with this. It was more of a proof of concept. But it definitely came out much better than we thought it could, and want to share it with everybody out there, because it's not limited just to the maintenance realm. It can be used for instruction or any other kind of instructional type videos, or I should say video sharing, that people would want to get the idea across to a newer generation of people. All right, let's just go ahead and move on. So the Technology Enhanced Aviation Maintenance Technical Manual, or TEAM-TM that we put it, was a DoD initiative. They're looking to take younger soldiers or airmen or sailors and kind of tie them in with technology through the maintenance program that the military currently has, which at this point right now is a PDF printout on a piece of paper, or you take a laptop out to the aircraft that you're working on, and you read line by line, the way we did in the old school days, what the maintenance task is, with a illustration once or twice in there, which we're told not to use. We're supposed to use the verbiage, not the illustration, which kind of flies in the face of everything that our younger people out there are dealing with on a day-to-day basis. I'm sure a lot of people here have had work either around the house or appliances or on their vehicles that they've opened up a YouTube video to see how to do it, versus reading a list of instructions on a web page. And that was where we were kind of aiming at, was how do we tie the video into the verbiage that was being presented on a PDF read document. So we went to a unit and we filmed them doing the actual maintenance procedures. And then we tied it into a HTML format, which could be used on any web browser, although Google Chrome seems to work the best. I do have a list of other ones at the end of this that it'll show functionality. It's not limited to those, but that's as far as we went with it. It also allows us to cross-reference maintenance manuals, informational manuals, pictures, lists, basically anything you need while you're doing the task, instead of having to open up a manual and find the TM number, then research the next TM number, find it, and then look at whatever it's referencing. This will, this program hot links you directly to that piece of referenced material. So it definitely reduces the amount of time that we spend searching for reference material and or illustrations. So, like I said, it was a DoD initiative trying to get the new soldiers to adapt to our maintenance system a little bit better. We can take a standard PDF procedure, put it into the video. Another really neat thing we were able to do was take 3D CAD and use it for both animations and for manual manipulation of parts and or subsystems on the aircraft. This allows the maintainer to look at a piece that's being referenced and actually almost like, virtually hold it in their hand prior to going out to the aircraft, so they know what they're looking for instead of having to go out and try to guess at it or have somebody come out and show them on the aircraft. And I'll caveat this whole thing with the seasoned maintainers out there probably don't need much of this type of presentation, because, they've got tribal knowledge and they've got the experience to back themselves up with. But the newer soldiers coming into the military, as a pilot, we had kids that didn't have a driver's license that we were training how to fly helicopters. So, there's a presumption of knowledge base that this kind of gets, it looks at the common denominator, and I won't say the lowest common denominator, but it starts at a very basic level and works its way up through the procedure steps. So if you are very experienced in it, you can skip over 90% of it. And if you have no experience in it, you can watch the entire thing as many times as you need to understand it. The digital format will reduce the amount of effort that it takes to update paper manuals that are out there right now. And it also reduces, it's good for the environment. We're not producing a whole bunch of paper waste. And I already mentioned that our references are hyperlinked. And the really neat thing about the video is that you can fast forward or back up by using the scrolling text to the side of it, which you'll see in a moment, which allows you to jump to a step or back up to a step that you've previously seen. All right, can you all hear me? Looks like we had a little bit of
Yep, you're good to go.
Okay, had a little cutout. Like I was saying, we're going to have scrolling procedure steps next to the video, which allows you to jump forward and back in the video so that you can either get to where you need to go or you can review something that you've previously seen or maybe missed because you were talking or noise or whatever. Okay. And next slide. So this is what we're looking at currently. This is how DoD presents the information to the soldiers, sailors, airmen. A PDF file that they can download to their computer, walk out to the aircraft and either read it off the computer or they can print it out. When they do print it out, it has the caveat saying that it can only be used this one time because updates may come down the line and you don't want to use outdated information. So you can see the illustrations that come with it. Basically, blueprint drawings that have been adapted to assembly, disassembly, or installation and removal steps. And it can be a bit confusing. If you take a look at the oil cooler on the left side of the photo there, the right side of that page is showing a cutout that's actually hidden by the oil cooler itself. And without having actually been out to an aircraft to understand how that looks, that can be quite confusing to a new soldier. All right, and at this point, I'm going to jump to the actual HTML presentation. I understand that the video will probably come across as a little choppy because we're basically running it off a computer through the web onto your computer, but I think it'll get the information across in a manner better than just simply looking at slides. And death by PowerPoint, nobody wants that. So I'm going to go ahead and share my desktop. And here we go. I'm going to share that. All right, everybody should see the new HTML in the Google Chrome web browser. This is how it opens up when you double click on it from an icon in your file explorer through Windows. I've not run this through Apple, so I don't know its connectivity ability there, but that is something that we could research in the future. So you only deal with one page for the most part with tabs across the top. Start page just simply being what task you're actually working off of. And what we did is we followed the format of the PDF, in which references was the next portion of the procedure. And as we said before, any reference that's in here, we're going to cross-reference to that actual manual to reduce research time in case you need to get the information quickly. Now, we don't actually have those manuals tied into this, but we do have blank placeholders put in there, which would simulate us actually going to the PDF, being able to go to the reference material. And whether or not it's just a one-page document or an entire technical manual, it'll open up in a new HTML page and it will stay open. So I'm actually toggling between the two pages. It'll stay open until you either don't need it or you close out the entire web browser. And then you can cross-reference any additional procedures which are referenced in this one. So this is a transmission alignment, and the engine install procedure was referenced as the first step that you need to do. So we can reference that, select it. It moves us over to the engine install procedure. We can run through this entire procedure and then come back to the original engine transmission alignment procedure. All right, moving on to the next. And as you can see, this is like a one-page document that I'm scrolling up and down on, but I can use the tabs at the top to go to the section that I want immediately. Again, required conditions. It tells me that I have a maintenance or a manual that I need to look at to make sure that I'm doing safe maintenance on the aircraft. So I can select that. And again, it sends me to the appropriate manual. Talking about required personnel, not much there. When you get down to support equipment, this is a vast improvement over the current system. In the PDF, it'll simply tell you that you need a toolkit, technical inspector, one. What it doesn't tell you is what it looks like this toolkit, general mechanic. It won't tell you what it looks like. We've also added inventory checklist, which we could cross-reference to an inventory checklist or any other reference material that would help you understand how to either use the piece of equipment you're using or what's supposed to be in it. And then again, we also have another reference here. So I've got a picture of this toolkit, and when I select it, it actually opens up so that you can look at the tool and get a better idea of what you're going to go to the tool room for. This actually happened to us while we were over filming one of the procedures. And they told us that there was a tool in the tool room. It had been there for 6 years and nobody knew what it was for. Nobody ever checked it out. It just sat in the tool room until finally somebody who had some tribal knowledge came and said, hey, you know what? This is the piece that you guys are missing for one of your rig checks that you guys have been manufacturing by hand. And it takes about 10 hours to manufacture the part. Whereas they had the tool in the room the entire time. Had there been a picture in the procedure, probably would have allowed them to use it in a much, much earlier, maybe from the get-go.
Hey, again, Sean, just to give you a heads up, if you, you're sharing, I don't know if you intended to or not, but you're sharing your webcam. If you make that, if you probably didn't share it, it might make the screen a little bigger from a viewer perspective here.
How does that work?
There you go. Yep, helps increase the size a bit. Thanks.
Okay. Yeah, you guys don't need to look at my mug. You need to look at the important stuff here. Okay. Anyways, that's the picture will stay open until you don't need it anymore or until you close it out. So, and as you can see, everything I've opened up so far, it just adds up at the top, doesn't go away, but can also be reselected at any time when you need it. All right, moving on to the actual, okay, well, we'll come down here and job completion requirements. Down here, there may be additional procedures that have to be done, such as transmission servicing or aircraft pre-flight. There could be something in here that would also be referenced to another manual or another procedure step. We would have that listed in here, being able to hot link it to that particular procedure step. And now back to the meat and potatoes of the effort here. So what we've got here is the display on how the soldiers will see it. And this over here on the left side is the video display where it's going to play the maintenance video that we put together. And on the right, the procedure steps straight out of the PDF will scroll as the video plays. Now, this is a very short video, very short procedure, a minute and 25. We had some that were as long as 47 minutes for rig checks on a CH-47, but we kept it small for presentation purposes. And this one had the best spit and polish on it. So we went ahead and used it for demonstration purposes. Within the window, you can reference different figures that came along with the PDF. So what we've done is we've taken everything in the PDF, put it in this, and then enhanced everything that went with it. So you're not losing anything out of the original PDF procedure. You're simply gaining more with access to the original. So we've got figure one, which is selectable. And then we also have a 3D rendering, which I will show you in a moment. But what I'm going to do is go ahead and start the video, and I apologize for the choppiness, but it should get the point across. Okay, I'm going to pause right there. We left this video a little fast to highlight the usability of the scrolling text on the side. Installing that cone went a little fast, so maybe I need to go back and double check that. So what I can do is I can select step one, and I can go ahead and play, and I can repeat the entire step. Okay. So I was able to go back. I was able to look at the procedure, procedure step again to the exact spot that I wanted to look at. I mean, within the step. But I'm an experienced user and I really don't have, you know, okay, I know how to do step one. What I don't know is how to do step two. So I can go ahead and fast forward to step two and select play. All right, I'm going to pause right there. You heard them say maximum run out, not to exceed TM limits. And if you look at the verbiage written on the side on the scrolling text, it talks about, you know, 0.10 of an inch and 0.050 for the maximum run out. Those specifics can change based on aircraft manufacturers' recommendations. And as a maintainer, I saw that happen quite a bit. Torques that had been, you know, tried and true for 10 years were suddenly changed because they went to a new manufacturer or they found something wrong with the system. So rather than revamping the entire video every time a change happens, we went ahead and used generics in the video dialogue or in the prompting that pops up. And then we left the exact specifications in the text to the right. So while you can actually use this video standalone without any scrolling text, you will need to still reference the scrolling text on the right for specifics that aren't specified in the actual video. And what I just did there was I went ahead and maximized the video playback if I want to see the entire thing on a screen without the video or without the scrolling text on the right.
And hey, Sean, just to let you know, the audio from the video that you're playing isn't coming through to the presentation. So from an audience standpoint, we're not able to hear the audio from that.
Okay.
Just keep that in mind.
All right. Well, okay. So to clarify what I just said, we have an audio narration through the entire procedure and they are talking you through what is written on the right side, but they use, you know, they kind of summarize what's being said on the right and they don't say exactly everything that's in the procedure step. I'm kind of paraphrasing. And every once in a while, they'll throw in some lessons learned or a way to do it better, as long as it is DOT approved and it doesn't conflict with, you know, maintenance, you know, safe maintenance procedures. And what they had said while they were talking about the runout was that it should not to exceed TM limits. And then that's where I went in to tell you that it's actually detailed on the right side there in the text. So if you were able to see this video while it plays, it's got some really cool background music and it's got a guy's voice that he actually produced it. But instead of hiring a actual narrator, he ended up doing it and he did a fantastic job. So I'm sorry you guys are unable to hear that, but I'll go ahead and continue from this point. And at this point, we are now at a 3D graphics representation. And I'll go ahead and let it play and then I'll talk about it for a moment. The narration said to reverse the tool and the cone. Again, he says maximum runout, not to exceed TM limits. You can see the actual limits in the text on the right. So I would like to highlight the fact that this 3D representation was done off of the 2D representation that was in figure one. So they took this drawing from figure one and they were actually able to make that 3D representation for the video with very little effort. What they also did, which is not displayed here, and I can show it later, is we used metrology, services metrology group to go out and scan with digital scanners, actual tools and or parts and even areas of the aircraft. And those were then rendered in 3D. So you have an exact replica down to you know, the 1,000-inch part, piece, or area that you're working in to get a better idea of what you're actually going to be touching, seeing, and doing out on the aircraft. And what I'll do is I'll open up the rendering now, which I already have open. So this was the 3D image that they did, and it can open up in an independent PDF file, which allows for manipulation, so that if I want to go out to the aircraft and take a look at this piece and say, I'm not sure exactly what I'm looking at here, well, I can actually manipulate it to look at it in any direction that I might actually see on the real aircraft. And this one's very simple. Some of them are very complex, entire areas or subsystems of the aircraft. And this is done through PDF shock. Now, I do know that the shock is being replaced sometime this year, but I'm sure they're going to have some kind of replacement that we'll be able to use to do the exact same thing. All right. And I'll just go ahead and let the video finish up real quick. All right. And as highlighted before, I can play the video full screen, or I can play it in embedded in the HTML webpage. I can turn the audio on and off. If I'm out on the flight line, it's really noisy. I've got the procedure steps to the right. I don't have to worry about the audio actually being heard. And that takes us to the resources page. Resources page is going to give you basically one-stop shopping for everything that you were referencing earlier in the procedure. You've got the 3D rendering that we just looked at. The procedure video, it's going to bounce you back to the procedure portion. And I'll talk about the AR, VR tools after we get done with this and we move on back to the PowerPoint presentation. Again, that figure that was selectable on the procedure video, it's here for you to view. And then down to credits, in addition to any further assistance, the current Army system is a 2028 form that you have to submit recommendations for changes, mistakes, errors that they find in the procedures, or anything that you can do better. Ideally, you could now email that stuff to whoever's handling the production of these videos and web pages and have the input sent directly to them. And of course, contingent upon DOT's approval, but a much faster turnaround than the 2028 system that the Army uses. And I'm not sure what the Air Force or Navy Marines use, but it's probably something similar. So that is it, except for the help page. And in the help page, we have a PDF how-to. It's a how to use the manual. And I talked earlier about Chrome being the best use, or being able to display this the best. Firefox also works really well. Internet Explorer, we had limited video capability with it, and then we didn't try anything with Safari or Opera or any other web browsers that are out there. And, you know, understand this was a proof of concept. We didn't go real down deep into the weeds to figure out what it would work best on across the platforms. We just looked at what was being used in DoD right now as the main systems. And while Internet Explorer is, you know, preferred by DoD, we all know that Chrome and Firefox are probably what everybody else is using. And then it also talks about how to install the actual videos procedures into your computer. And the nice thing about this is you don't have to have the entire manual on your computer. You can download just one task to your computer, take it out to the aircraft. You won't be able to hotlink to the other procedures that it references, but you'll have the procedure that you're trying to do aircraft side. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and stop the screen share and return to our presentation. All right. Okay, so let's see, that's the same thing. All right, so what we were looking at was linking completed steps to an interactive technical manual to auto-populate the logbooks. And what that blah, 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 blah means is as you go through the video, it would auto-populate the aircraft's logbook with the steps that you are completing so that you didn't have to manually enter all of these. You would just have to go through and write completed, torqued. You'd have to do the completion steps manually, but you wouldn't have to do the initial installation of this required, installation of that required. It would automatically generate as the text scrolls and goes through the video. We'd also like to try to get some metadata capture of the procedure component's use. And what I mean by that is, what portions of the videos are being used the most? And are they skipping over certain areas? That way we can focus on relevance and we can reduce redundancy. One thing that was identified by our customer was anytime that there was a safety, which was a caution, warning or note, that they would like to see the video pause and have some kind of positive selection on the webpage of, yes, I understand this warning, caution, or note, and then you would be able to proceed. That way there's no chance of, you know, something being missed and, you know, maybe possibly aircraft being damaged or loss of life because somebody missed this step. And that was just something that we hadn't put in yet, but it definitely is going to be in the future. All right. Yeah, I believe somebody actually said that the actual torque number needs to be inputted on some steps. And I believe the Air Force does something similar to that already. My son's a load toad in the Air Force, and he's seen this presentation. He likes it. They already have something similar to it, but maybe not as robust as what we're doing. Okay, so the virtual reality portion wasn't a part of our initial push, just that we could maybe do it. Service actually has an in-house company that we work with that already does VR stuff, and they told us that it would take hardly anything to add it into this virtual technical manual, and so that we could take a look at, as you can see here, this is a virtual model of a Abrams that they did, and it's showing not only the entire tank, but it's showing the internal structure of the tank, which ideally you'd be able to select an area of the tank, double click on it, and it would enlarge itself to that subsection, and then we could double click into it, you know. And this is if you want to explore the area of the vehicle. If you have an actual component that you want to go directly to, then that would be selectable also. And using VR goggles and hands, you would be able to actually manipulate this object in virtual reality and see it fit in the subsector or the subsection that it's being put into, so that subassembly's completed look would be seen, and also disassembled, it would be seen. This is something that would have benefited me greatly in my first 2 years in the maintenance field, because I basically had to have somebody come out and babysit me out there, showing me how to do a lot of things that I had never done before. And then we are also, in the absence of having to use goggles, this would also be something that could be presented on the screen using some sort of controller interface that you could still manipulate it on the screen. You just wouldn't see it as if it was a 3D model right in front of you. All right. So with no further ado, looks like my last slide's not here. In summary, we've got a technical manual that aims at the YouTube user that hopefully the younger soldiers could use out there in the maintenance fields. What we're looking at is I see this as something that could be used greatly with the learning environment. You know, they go to tech school to learn how to do all of this. You know, what a great way to be able to not have to crawl around on the aircraft. You can get, you know, sometimes you're limited by the number of people you can put around a subassembly for people to look at. Now you can have an entire classroom looking at a subassembly that's being manipulated on screen in front, but by an instructor. So this is, I think, an invaluable learning tool for people that are both learning and then also actually out using the systems in the maintenance fields. And I'm kind of drawing a blank on anything else to add. If we want to go ahead and move on to questions, I will go ahead and field those.
Sure. Yeah, let's do that. All right. Thanks, Sean. So I'm going to go ahead and present these on the screen. I will go ahead and just echo them back here so folks can hear them, and then I'll let you respond, Sean, and we'll we'll follow through them accordingly. If you don't have your question in and you wanted to ask a question to Sean about this, again, there's a little dialogue box at the top of your screen. You can enter it, and then we'll get to it in time. All right, so first one here. How do we account for the utility of the computer-based video in light of often occurring updates? Has there been standard language to allow the government to modify the files itself?
So in the video itself, I talked about them using generics so that it wouldn't have to be updated every time a specific change came out. Also, the individual steps for each one of these is stitched together. So the procedure step, it's something like 20 different, views or camera takes on it. Any one of those can be updated and then stitched back in a lot easier than doing one continuous video that you never stop filming and then having to change one thing in the middle of it. So they did think about that. The stitching in was relayed to me by a bright idea that it was very easy to do, and whoever manages this could do it in a timely manner, of course, with DoD approval on the recommended improvement. Does that answer the question?
Unfortunately, the questioner won't be able to speak. They're just in kind of listen mode.
Okay.
So we'll assume so. If Greg, if you have a follow-up for that, you can enter it. So we'll proceed here. All right, next question. Can you explode the view? As is, your webcam is at the top. Oh, it's taking up space. So I guess, here we go. We got that.
Roger that. Sorry about that.
No worries. All right. Would this replace the need for 40051-2C technical manuals, or in addition to the mil standard ITEMs?
I'm not familiar with the 451. I would need more information. I might be familiar with it. I just don't know it's called that because my maintenance experience ended in 1999 when I went to the dark side and became a pilot. And I really haven't touched maintenance since coming back to this. So I was able to jump back in on the Mike model Blackhawks, which were using the PDFs that we saw, but I haven't gone into weeds with the other type of maintenance manual systems that are being used out there. And like I said, the Air Force is using some stuff now that I'm not familiar with, but it sounds similar to what we are trying to do, just a little less interactive. All right, next question. And if you need, sorry, caveat to that is if you would like more information about that, I can definitely dig in the weeds for it.
Good. All right. Next question. Is there a functionality to document or sign off initial critical tasks built into the system?
So, yeah, we mentioned that briefly. We definitely would want some kind of acknowledgement for any kind of warning, caution, or note. And then additionally, if there was information that needed to be entered in, like a torque value, we could enter that in or have it added in, with a future update, which would auto update the aircraft logbook showing that, hey, so-and-so actually did this and put it in. Right now, it's limited to what's put in the logbook.
All right, perfect. All right, next question. Is the manual being presented able to be used as a standalone, or is the expressed intent for it to be an accompaniment to the printed or PDF?
So, excellent question. Our customer's ultimate idea for this is to be able to take your cell phone out and be able to use it off a cell phone without having to lug a big computer out there. So they do want it to be a standalone without having a paper printout along with it. And the idea of that also being that the updates are going to be very quick and, you know, it could be done in the middle of the night when nobody's using the system, or even while people are using the system. The chance of you getting some outdated information probably won't last more than a day. So, definitely standalone.
That's great. All right. Are there captions available for the embedded videos? Would have been good in the situation today.
I don't know. I can look into that. You do have the scrolling text on the right, which, you know, like I said, the narrator is paraphrasing a lot of what is being done on the right. But, based on what DOTD would want, they may want the narration to be exactly what the scrolling text is. And in that case, there wouldn't be a need for the captions. But I could look up and see if the captions are necessary. Let me write that down. Or if the captions are available, sorry.
I'll give you a second here to write that down.
Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. All right, next question. All right, so is this interface available for plug and play or any system or component requiring maintenance? Also, what is required for viewing these forms of detecting manuals?
As far as plug and play, you can take a DVD or a Blu-ray, which, I mean, I understand. Hardly any computer has that anymore. You could also put it on a memory stick, plug it into your computer, and then install it. For the videos to play, you do have to actually install some of the video into the computer. I don't know how the process works. Our IT people did that for us. But as far as the requirements, like I said, we aimed at Google, Google Chrome and Firefox being the best supported with what we were working with. But it doesn't mean that we can't make Internet Explorer also, you know, that usable. It would just take more work than we were able to put into it. So I would say an updated web browser in addition to a computer that's able to play, you know. So the videos that we're using, you guys can't really see it because it was probably choppy and not the best quality, but they look 1080p beautiful. And those are actually substantially crushed video from what they were produced as. They were produced as TV quality video. And I was telling Brian earlier, the guys that produced this were almost crying on how much we had to crush it because we had to keep the size down. That was one of the constraints on us, was to make sure that this was all under 1 gig. So, you know, bring it in with a memory stick and plug it into a computer, install it within 2 minutes and have it up and going as a standalone.
Yeah, that's great. So I guess somewhere there's a TV quality video available.
Yes. Yeah. If you're able to download it, which, you know, I can talk to my boss and see if there's a way for us to make it available for people to download and take a look at. We've done it for a couple of in-house people that were looking at it for instructional purposes, and being able to download it and install it would be of a much better benefit than just looking at PowerPoint presentations and a choppy video presentation on a webinar.
Yeah. All right. Next question. What software was used to render the CAD models from the scans? And what software was used to incorporate step stop points in the video?
All right. So for scans, I'm writing this down real quick. I'm going to have to ask my metrology guys what they used for the scans. They used a ferro arm for part of it, and then they used some handheld scanners, which I couldn't tell you what software they used to stitch it all together. I'm not that smart. But the software to use and incorporate the step stop points, that again too, I'll have to ask our guys what those would be. You know, these were, we were told that it was doable, but we weren't told the exacts of it, you know, and with funding limitations on the initial contract, we just didn't go into it that deep. I'm sorry, can't answer that any further.
Okay, no, that's fine. All right, next question. Was an animated CAD shown? If so, it didn't come across. Okay, yeah, I don't think you showed an animated CAD. Or you just showed the...
Okay, yeah, stand by real quick here. Let me delve into my stuff here. And tail rotor rig. Oil cooler, here we go. And procedure. 3D CAD. Let me see. I'm trying to download it.
Yeah, right.
Here we go.
No, in one of the in the one video, you did show kind of a computer drawing of a shaft that was
right.
Moving.
Okay.
And being,
so what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and take control of not that one. I'm going to go ahead and take control of the presentation, and I will show you. Okay. Maybe 10% rule, right?
Maybe.
10% smarter than you. Using? Okay. Can we, Brian, can we stop the, well, never mind, I can do it. I'm going to stop Q&A for a second here, and then, all right, location window, and I think it was, So what I've got is, this is, let me see if I can do full screen here. Let's hide that. And then do screen mode. Okay. So this was an actual 3D CAD of, clicked it. Still, well, maybe. That's it. This was a 3D CAD of the UH-60 oil cooler and its compartment. And they scanned this using their metrology equipment. And let me zoom in a little bit on it. Let me try going back to full screen here. Might be too much for this poor computer. Here we go.
All right. It's catching up.
Okay. So you're able to select portions that were actually scanned individually. And you're able to zoom in and get the amount of fidelity that you can't get with a line drawing. Oopsie. Okay. Now, on the previous, let me zoom out a little bit here. On the previous, when I showed you the figure that had a diagram in it of an oil cooler, what it was showing was, let me zoom out a little bit here. It was showing this area right here that I'm currently circling, but it was trying to show you through the side here in a little cutaway. And with this 3D representation, you can see that it makes it a whole lot easier to manipulate and get a better view of what you're looking at so that you're no longer in the dark about what am I doing here? What am I looking for? Okay, here's my access panel. Here's my oil cooler output flange. Here's my viscous bearing right here. Here's the support flange. There's the mount bolt holes that it talks about putting shims on. So this is giving you a better idea of a better visual representation of what you're looking for when you're doing the video. And this wasn't even our best 3D representation.
Hey, Sean, just had a question come by that's relevant to this. You know, why did you use scans instead of just the original CAD model of the system?
So we didn't use any original CAD models. We did that one, the alignment tool. We did that off of a diagram because we figured out after we had filmed it that we had forgotten to scan the actual tool. And the metrology guys went ahead and just put one together real quick out of that 2D drawing that they had and made a 3D graphic representation of it. But most of the other stuff that we did with the longer videos, so this oil cooler video is like 33 minutes long. And we did the oil cooler itself. We did the shims. We did the input flanges. We did, I think, the tail rotor servo because you have to lock it out. No, I'm sorry. That was on the rig check. But I'd say all in all, we did 30 different parts and or sub-assemblies and areas. We scanned them, including an entire broom closet, which on a CH-47, the broom closet is right behind the pilot and co-pilot. And it's, they call it that because there's push rods that go up and down inside of it. It looks kind of like a broom, a bunch of brooms laying in there. But those are the control rods that connect the controls in the cockpit to the swash plates up underneath the rotor system. And we did an entire 3D scan of that entire compartment there, which it took like 2 days for the rendering to be complete after they had stitched it all together. But it's down, you know, you could even see grease stains in it. It was that accurate. Did that answer the question?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. All right. I'm going to go ahead and come back to the presentation. And
you want me to jump back into the audience questions? Is that all right? Or
yeah, can you do that? I'll go ahead and stop screen share.
Absolutely. Where do we leave off? That's the question.
One of the questions.
Okay. You know what? Actually, this is a smart system. It kind of leaves us off. So the next question is in line. It is an easy one. I'll answer it. Can we receive a copy of this recording or the slide deck? A kind of modified version of the slide deck is available on the DSIAC website for this webinar. So you can find it there. a copy of this recording. Yes, we'll send out an announcement later tonight of where you can get that. Short answer is it should be on our YouTube channel, but you can access it through our website as well. And then if you have any other further questions, you certainly can contact Sean, myself, Brian Benish, and we'll get you in touch, you know, get you some more information about either getting another briefing of this or recording or whatever else you might need. All right, next question was, can this technology be used with condition-based maintenance training and techniques?
All right, I'll be honest, I don't know what condition-based maintenance training is. If I can get a little bit more of a breakdown on what that is, then I might be able to answer that.
Okay, no, that's fair enough. We'll jump to the next one in the meantime. Is this a government requirement that you're trying to capture? I suspect in the effort overall.
Yes, this was a government effort. It was a part of, there were three parts there to the contract. We were only one section of it. And we did, you know, they were very pleased with what they got from us. And they were going to try to roll it in with adaptive maintenance and AI. So AI in our section, and neither was the adaptive maintenance portion of it. But it does kind of tie in what I was saying about gathering metadata off of the procedure steps and trying to figure out what exactly is being used the most and what isn't being used the most. And something I had forgotten to tell you is this is going to be for more complicated tasks. You know, a simple panel being taken off the aircraft and put back on, you're not going to waste money making a video about, you know, that. It's going to be, hopefully you've got people out there that are, you know, smart enough to know how to take a panel off, you know, remove 12 screws, remove panel. Okay, now we're going to work on the inside, and that's what the video is going to capture, is, you know, how do we do the nuts and bolts of this complicated task after we've taken off that panel.
Yep. All right, next question. So do you use S1000D specification or other standards for preparing and managing technical manuals?
We would. We didn't with this, you know, because it was a proof of concept. It would ask DOTD's, you know, thumbs up or thumbs down based on, you know, what they decide. But it would have to meet that specification if it was being used out in the field right now.
Mm-hmm. Okay, perfect. You might have mentioned this already, but so what software was used to incorporate the stop points in the video and to render the CAD model? So same thing, that you kind of jotted that down as a question to be answered. You have to look up.
Yeah, you know, being able to pause the video, that's just part of the media player. The stop points that I had talked about future use would have to be something that IT would get back to me on.
No, it's fine. All right. So how is this different from AMCOM's IADS, decided by the Army last year to be the forward-leaning IETM platform?
I can't speak intelligently on this. I was not a part of the IADS, and this was done last year. So maybe they went with something else, and this was what they didn't go with. I can't tell you that, because all we were briefed is, thank you very much. It's outstanding. We'll get back to you.
Okay. All right. So to use all these features, does the user need to be connected to a secure network, or will they be able to have full access to all features offline?
So as it stands now, if you've got it on a memory stick, all features are usable. Obviously, if you're dealing with classified, secret, or, you know, even TSI stuff, you would have to have some kind of secure computer that you would not be able to interface with a memory stick. So it would have to be downloaded through a zipper, and then probably used in a zipper environment, and not taken out to the aircraft. But honestly, at least for the maintenance procedures that we were dealing with, there was nothing classified about them. So everything was able to be used offline.
That's good. Okay, so question about utilizing this system technical manual, I guess maybe virtual reality. So how would any obsolescence or modification changes become real-time updates?
So the idea is, I mean, you've got an entire procedure and a little tiny piece changes. Well, by keeping the size small of the entire procedure, like the biggest procedure we had, 47-minute long video, for CH-47 rigging, stage two, it was all under one gig. So you could just replace the entire module at one time. You wouldn't have to worry about picking little pieces out of it. The entire thing would be updated at whoever's taking care of it, whoever the managers are of updating it, and then it would be pushed out to be downloaded as it becomes available.
Good, very good. All right, next question. So are users able to generate recorded content?
No, not at this time. I guess you could do some kind of third-party video capture of what you're looking at on your screen, kind of like what's happening right now with this webinar, but we didn't incorporate anything into that with the system. Although you can send an email to somebody requesting, hey, you guys missed this step, or you can say, hey, here's a better way of doing it. And then it gets vetted, either gets added or, thank you for your submission. It was not going to be used at this time.
Right. Okay. So is the Army accepting this format as a formal manual at this time? And regardless, is there a standardized format that we could or should follow?
So the Army is not using this right now. As I said, it was just a prototype. They would probably come out with guidelines telling us how they would like to see it done better or more standardized, but those have not been given to us. We were given free rein to make it any way we thought. And, it's really up to DoD. Unless we come up with something so great that they don't want to change it, it'll be up to DoD to decide on what the standardized format will be.
Yeah. Okay.
And I'll just add to that real quickly. The whole premise behind it was to make it as user-friendly as possible, as intuitive as possible, because I know everybody here has gone to a corporate website and they can't find, half the stuff they need to do in order to update their insurance or whatever. And it gets frustrating when you can't figure out a website because it's not intuitive. The idea was making that maintenance so intuitive that it was almost makes you, we're not trying to talk down to you, but we're trying to make it as foolproof as possible.
No, that makes sense. All right. So how about security measures? What security measures are required to help prevent the corruption of the HTML data?
Right now, none. If you know how to edit HTML, you could go in and really screw this thing up. I'm sure it would be explored in the future, but as of right now, nothing. I mean, I get it. A lot of the younger kids, they know how to do that kind of stuff. Yeah, we're at their mercy right now, but obviously it wouldn't be released unless there was a way of preventing it from being corrupted. That's for the smart people.
Right. Yeah. So you've demonstrated the prototype in terms of the interactive manual, but in terms of the security of it, that's maybe a next step.
Right. And HTML, we used it because we thought, our thinking was, what's available out there that doesn't require new software to be either purchased or installed, what's already existing, and what is being used by everybody out there. So mm-hmm. If you have a driver's license or not, you have used a web browser. And, unless you're in a third world country that has no internet connectivity and no computers, you have used a computer, you have used a web page, so you can use our manual. That was the idea of using HTML.
Okay. And I think you addressed this already. Are users able to generate recorded content?
Right. Not at this time.
Not this time. All right. And then how do you author and distribute content to users? So I think you've already addressed that a couple times maybe.
Yeah. And that's something that would have to be developed by whoever's given the contract to generate this and manage it. It would probably be from a server farm somewhere that, you would talk secure to, maybe VPN to it, and download your latest updates.
Okay. Okay. Next question might get into some particulars, might not be an answer off the cuff here, but what HTML, video, and PDF tools are required to build or edit the digital manuals?
So right now, you could ask any IT person, how do I edit an HTML webpage? And that answer will allow you to manipulate the data that's in this right here. The video, that was done by a film company. And I mean, I've used some of the Vegas software and done some pretty neat videos on my own, homemade. So you could you could use pretty much any kind of video stuff and PDF tools. The people that do our web browser for our service engineering, they're the ones that generated the PDF portion of this program. So it's not, I don't want to say it condescendingly, it's not rocket science. Pretty much anybody who knows anything about this would be able to work on it.
Understood. Okay. So here, does this do a little backwards compatibility here? Does this have the ability to be printed off if you have electronic issues as a backup measure?
And we discussed that, and all it would take is the addition of a download button. We have a download for the PDFs. When it opens up in the PDF browser, it's downloadable. So you'd be able to download it at that point, and then you'd be able to print it off at that point.
Okay. So yeah, again, this question here is just about being able to download and try the manual on their own. Probably the best way is to get in touch with you, Sean, correct?
Right. Yeah. And I'll coordinate that through service and see if there's something that we can't do. We can't put up on the web on our website that would allow something like this to be pushed out.
Okay. Okay. Here we go. Some services at times Marine Corps have a DSIAC/SICA relationship, share different military equipment versions, which at times share tactical manuals jointly. And at times the individual service would issue modification instructions to reflect the difference in a procedure and or component being replaced, which may be a different capability. How would the system compensate for these various changes? Usable on codes?
And I had forgotten to mention the fact that, systems that are generic across the services would be able to use one video, for all the services, like that oil cooler. It's the same on the Mike model as it is on the Alpha model, and it's the same on the Sierra model that the Navy uses. So it could be used for everybody. Updating the individual information for specifics on each airframe, I would hazard to say that they would probably end up doing a different video for like maybe a hot link to if you're working on a Mike model and this modification is installed, go here. And then that would open up a new module, which would be specifically tailored to the Mike model with that particular modification. And nobody else would have to download that module to work on the aircraft if they didn't have that particular model number or modification. That's what I see it being able to, how we would be able to do it. But again, that's big Army. Well, our contract was for Army. It would either be DoD or, whatever service would want to be in charge of that, I imagine, and whoever manages it. Okay. Sorry, I can't answer that anymore.
Yep. All right. And then this is pretty much our last question coming up next here. So I heard the words initiative and prototype. Is there a plan to complete this for an entire vehicle or aircraft? And if so, what is the level of effort in terms of cost and time?
So right now, we have not received word from the government on moving forward. And the initial cost on this one for 6 tasks, it was just under $1 million, but part of that was also developing the way we were going to do it. It's going to be costly for each aircraft, but again, you don't have to do every single thing that the aircraft has. And it's not just limited to aircraft, like you said, vehicle/aircraft. This could be done for a generator. This could be done for a four-wheeled vehicle. It could be done for, a piece of computer.
Looks like we're losing Sean's audio here for a moment, but his icon is showing him spinning, so he should be jumping back in. Yep, lost you for a moment there, Sean, but I think it looks like you're back in.
Sorry about that. Where was I? So as far as the effort level, it took us, you're looking at the bulk of the time was in editing the video that they did, as well as the 3D renderings of the scans. That's where most of the time came. We would do most of the shootings. One shooting took us 3 days to do. And that wasn't continuous 8 hours a day. That was, you know, availability of the aircraft, availability of the maintainer to show us stuff. But I'd say it was probably about 20 hours worth of effort. And then that was for a 47 minute long video. So that was just videotaping it. And then the editing it, that's, it took probably, I'd say 3 to 4 weeks, 3 weeks for each, well, for that big one, it took about 4 weeks to get that one done. And then, the, you know, and they stack on it. Well, they don't stack. They run concurrently with each other. The rendering, the stitching together of the scans for the 3D content, that's being done at the same time that the editing is being done. So you don't lose anything there. But it was about four, I'd say about four solid weeks of work for a 47 minute long video. But that was a very intensive video. I want to say it was over 300 steps, and it was, and I could be wrong. It could be 400. I haven't looked at it in a while, but, yeah. And as far as the cost goes, I think once you get the, you know, formatting and everything down, you're going to start seeing some cost sharing with components that are shared across different procedures, as well as, like we said, using the same procedure for multiple aircraft slash vehicles that don't have a specific, you know, a specification that individualizes them.
Okay. Well, that's all we have question wise. Appreciate everybody sticking it out for those who are remaining with us. Sean, thanks so much for your time and the presentation. And as I've mentioned a couple times already, if anyone does have any questions, any more detailed questions, you can get in touch with myself, Brian Benish, send an email to the contact alias at DSIAC, or get in touch with Sean directly. We'd be happy to go from there. So again, thank you, Sean. Thank you, everybody who has been present for this.
Thank you, everybody. Appreciate it.